annually give them, but on a morning like this, when they're going in for the test, and they're all, you know, pretty tight about it, we try to get them to relax a bit and help them and put it into perspective what it actually means. So, and then they're going bowling. How does it get better than that? They're going to go out for pizza, and then they're going to go bowling. So, they're going to have a great day. So, I just want to go over a few things, I hope that you've all noticed that our current eighth grade has their C up on the wall in the lobby, and actually we haven't had the which as a community we're going to have them presented to the entire school, to all of us, because they represent and they set the tone and they are the role models for who we are, and the kids really truly look up to them. And even the seventh graders are trying to emulate the eighth graders, which is the great reason why we don't have a high school, because those seventh graders would be trying to emulate the 12th graders, which is not what we want. Another great example of, which I thought at the Halloween, at our Halloween assembly, I kept thinking, those eighth grade girls that were up there singing, they had been practicing in the afternoon, and they were practicing when people from upper school was going to lunch, and the kids, the other eighth graders were singing, the other upper schoolers were singing along with them, and all I could think about was, if they weren't in an environment like this, those girls would no more get up there and do what they did than the man on the moon. We couldn't have gotten them up there. And they loved every minute of it. And so, and the kids loved it too. So those are all the things that, you know, aren't on the report card, they're not tangible, but that's the, instilling that kind of self-confidence and comfort level, because there was an eighth grader up there, this is her first year here, that if you saw her in the hallway, she might not even look up at you because she's that shy until she gets to know you. But there she was up on stage. And that's about the sense of community and character and how Chapin works hard to celebrate who each child is and give them the confidence then to move on and truly be an advocate for themselves. So that's what I'll say about that. Curriculum, right now we're, you know, so I don't miss anyone. Our extracurricular groups are up and running. Our mock trial, the science olympiad for both the lower and the upper school, robotics, the math olympiad, all those things, all those, what's the word I'm looking for? It's Friday. And I started at 7 with the baby, so. all those
clubs.
Extracurricular?
Yeah, clubs. Thank you, Mr. Barnowski. And such a simple word. All those clubs are already, you know, up and running. The instrumental program. There are children that get here at 7 o'clock in the morning to practice and be part of the instrumental program. With the different ensembles, and again, just a tidbit of how dedicated the faculty is. Mark Lederer, who often plays with the ensembles, he had taken a personal day and and all of the time that you're volunteering. And so I see all these events and they keep coming up and coming up, and I think, oh my gosh, you know, these are, you're volunteering to do this. And it's like never ending. It's never ending. But without it, when we talk about who we are and this is who we are, we would not be who we are without you. So, and it is truly do that.
You get some.
But it's just really, really exciting, really cool, and we want to share that. So there'll be a coffee and conversation, another one that'll happen in the early spring so that you can come in, you'll have some hands-on activities, you'll get to have that experience. Our kids will teach you some of the things that they've been learning, so it's very hands-on and very interactive. But it's just really exciting to see how tweaks and changes in a curriculum play out over many, many years. And I see many of you here who have young children, and it's cool to imagine just what they're going to be accomplishing in just a couple years. So that was that big thing. And then the last piece that I just wanted to share with you is in the 35 days that the kids have been in school, most of that time early on is spent establishing a really strong classroom community, helping them to understand how to respect each other, listen, learn, set the foundation for all the things that we are doing. And it's complex work for little kids. How do you take turns? How do you share? How do you dial down being competitive? How do you know what places to pull out and share all of your knowledge? That's hard for them to figure out. But they have done it beautifully. And when I look around this room, I know that it's not just because of Chapin, it's because of the modeling that they see in each and every single one of you. So I just want to say thank you for being a partner with me and with all the faculty in helping your kids grow. Okay?
Yes.
So good morning, everybody. I'm gonna run out in a minute. I don't know if you told me we're doing this.
Okay.
Okay. All right. So that's where I'll run out in a second. Some of your children are testing right now. So it's been a while since I've seen all of you. So thank you. And just a couple of things that have been happening in the upper school since we last met. We've gone to Camp Mason where we had a really great time. We've made some changes based on feedback that we've been getting. You know, it's kind of one of those things that in Camp Mason and we're always trying to look at every event, but like they just kind of happen. And then we just kind of do the same that we're, you know, the tendency could be to just do the same thing, but listening to the eighth graders last year and seventh graders, we made some changes, and one of the best parts of it was the karaoke night that we did, which was, I know many of you have seen the video, so I won't you know, get too much into that, but it was just like such a great, great event for them to just be kids and yell into microphones and be silly. So we really enjoyed being up there with them, and they're gonna do it again now. The seventh graders, you know, when we got done, and I asked them if they want to do it, like they're all in for next year, and like really showing the now sixth graders like how to have a proper karaoke night. The secondary schools since we last met, also where I erroneously gave you the date for our like coffee conversation for demystify the secondary schools process, that was very well attended. So thank you for coming. It also shows confirms that there's a lot of interest early on how to, you know, we have, you know, us as administrators and teachers, we kind of have all these answers and we know that the process is smooth and like kind of how to do all of this, but we're understanding a little bit better that parents have questions earlier and earlier now. So very well attended. We also opened up the secondary school fair to the greater community, and that was also very well attended by people. I think we had maybe fourth grade families here. So like just, you know, a lot of interest in how that process goes and talking to schools. We brought in some representatives, admission representatives from Pomfret School and Canterbury School who met with some of our eighth graders. We're gonna have somebody from Choate here November 15th, in case some of you have eighth graders here. But, you know, it's an opportunity basically for, and if you remember kind of how high schools operate, like high schools will have representatives from colleges and you can kind of go in as an open house throughout the day. So here during the morning recess, actually the eighth graders will get a chance to sit down with somebody from Chum. So I already have one of the families that said like, yes, I want to make sure my son gets in there. So so some other things that have been happening are the clubs that we started last year and one sport. So just really briefly, Mock Child has kind of narrowed down their topic for what they're gonna be interested in writing a court case about. If you're not too familiar with Mock Trial, you pick the organization kind of narrows down and picks down an area of law or civics where you should focus, and then the kids and with the faculty advisor, Emily Bowman, who's an eighth grade upper school social studies teacher, they're gonna have a school, so like a school like Chapin is gonna run an art contest, and in doing so, so like if you imagine the poster, you know, it's gonna say Chapin School Art Contest. They used a little snippet from an artwork that was an artist original artwork, and so they were sued for plagiarism, and actually like the last summer when this actually something very similar happened, it was on a website for a school website had used original artwork in a PowerPoint presentation, I think, and it didn't turn out well for the school, needless to say. So it's forced us to think about like, how we're using our website and making sure that the work out there is used properly. So they're working through it. Last year, George McClellan, who's one of our parents and a husband to somebody here, came in and taught with the Montreal kids. They loved it. He did great. So we're going to hopefully invite him back to help that group kind of navigate through that process again. So that's one. The Science Olympiad is the other group that we started last year. We have it's a busy room in there. We've got kids in pockets, and again, like you're given like a list of 15, 20 topics, you know, microbiology, physics, chemistry, all these different things, and like they're 7th and 8th graders are doing really high level high school level learning about sciences, and so they kind of just take that, and there's like a cluster of 3 that are learning about physics over here and chemistry over here. They're learning all that material on their own on top of their schoolwork, and then they go in on Science Olympiad Day. It's going to be December 8th. It's our first one, and they take tests and do different types of tasks to score points and things like that. So this is our second year doing that. It's pretty exciting. Well,
so last year was our first year, and on that Science Olympiad Day, that was a real first experience of being at this competition. And like Gil was saying, there are these just lists where these kids have to go in and take tests, and our kids weren't really prepared for all of it because we didn't really have a strong sense of everything that it would encompass. And they sat down first thing in the morning in this classroom, because everyone's like assigned to a classroom where you just hang out for about 12 hours. And they just picked off, like, okay, I'll go take this test. You and I will go do, you know, these two people will go. And went in so that they would have a sense of what the expectation was, even though they went in knowing that they were not prepared to do this. And no adult in the room was saying to them, well, you know, I think it would be a good idea if we did this today. They just said, no, we have to be part of this so we can be better prepared next year. And so that's...
Yeah. And one of the parents who was there last year, who's a physician, he like looked at some of the stuff that they were doing, and he was just like, they're being tested on stuff that I had in college, so it's really it moves fast in the middle school division. I don't even want to know what the high school division looks like. So, but it's a really, really competitive group of kids. They all want to do well. They all love learning what they're doing, and that's why they kind of take it on their own and do it at home and wherever they can. So that's coming up, and it's exciting. The last thing actually kind of dovetails a little bit with something you mentioned about our 8th graders, and you mentioned something about kids being competitive. So, and this happens, and it's a very, very normal part of growing up, is learning how to play nicely and then play nicely on the playground. And that journey sometimes lands in the middle school, sometimes earlier and sometimes later. So this year we have a very fiercely competitive group of 5th graders who are really into Gaga, and therefore we've been forced to really look at our rules for Gaga. And if any of you, I'm sorry. So Gaga is the octagonal enclosure out in the playground next to the swings and things like that. And it's a game that I would not recommend to anybody older than 14 years old, because you spend all of it hunched over, and it's like a combination of like dodgeball, bowling. So you hit the ball. You hit the ball with your hands,
it's
and if it hits you, right, it's in the sand pit. Like if it hits you below the waist, then you're out. You step out over the pen, and then get all the way down to the winner eventually. So it's a good alternative to dodgeball. No one's face is getting taken off, but it's a very competitive game, and the 5th graders are discovering that their competitiveness was I asked two of our eighth grade boys to play with them and model good, strong competitiveness without without all the things that can kind of fall off the wagon from that. So they went in, and it's been working. It's kind of a continuous work in progress, but it was really a nice, again, that testament to the kind of leadership that our eighth graders can demonstrate for our fifth graders, and it's helping them understand how to, you know, still be competitive and have some fun and understand how to follow rules and things like that. That translates to like to Foursquare. I never, you know, this going through all my school, I never thought that like I could probably teach a master's class in Gaga and Foursquare. So there's all sorts of variations for the rules, but that's, you know, these are all life lessons actually that they're going to be taking out from all that. Understanding sportsmanship is very important. That translates to our sports teams. But our eighth graders are instrumental in helping our current fifth graders navigate those waters. So I'm very proud of them.
And they were never like that.
Yeah, so yeah. And actually, you know, it's funny.
All Al-Qaeda, like Hall of Fame,
and bring back. Yes. Oh, that's, I was about to say, so my daughter as well, like, my, you know, we have a room right at the ready there because a lot of that sand ends up in the house. And we just haven't figured out, like, where. Like, we make her take off her socks and shoes now, and still eventually, like, you kind of feel, you know, like, just feel it, like, so. No way around that, but it's a lot of fun for the kids. We just put that in 4 years ago, and it kind of, it goes through periods of, like, really high interest. Right now, there's, like, a really, really high interest in Ghana, but it looks like a lot of fun. Just very painful for adults who fully formed bones. Speaking of competitive, I've seen with the parent pillow polo. I don't know that we can handle that. So, all right. I'm gonna go back to take our help our SSAT crew get through the day. They're going bowling actually. So another thing that we've done in the past couple of years, we've just let them out. Like, we used to keep them here for the rest of the day. So now after taking a 4-hour test, almost like they're gonna go bowling this afternoon. They're pretty excited for that. They had a dress down day. You know. About them today and helping them get through this. It's a long test. So,
if I may, I was waiting this morning and watched these kids come in that they were taking SSAT this morning, but one of the young men walked in, he said, "Math, I got this, let's go take this exam." He's like, "Why was studying?" And he's like, "He got late," and he's like, "I'm all over it." And I've never seen him excited about taking this exam. I almost keeled over.
Yeah, well, they do a lot of prep. I mean, like, they're, you know, it's funny watching them. They kind of are fist bumping each other. Like, we talk with them all in a room in the mezzanine. And then we're like, okay, guys, you like, you got this, let's go. And like, see a lot of little fist bumps and some handshakes. So they all encourage each other. They all understand that it's, yeah, while it's an important test, you know, they're still going to support one another with that. So, okay. Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Sure. I don't have very much. I just want to say that the charger now comes out around 3:00 on Fridays. If you're thinking it's just late, we planned that. So it kind of finishes the week and transitions right to the next week. So just keep an eye out for that around 3:15, just when it all gets finished. And again, if you see anything on the website or if you're confused by anything, just contact me and we can answer your questions or fix something, or if you good news you want to tell me, if you see something out there, just let me know. That's all for now.
Okay, hi. I have three things, I think. First is, I'm hoping that you've all gotten emails and things in the charger about Grandparents Special Friends Day, but I just want to briefly overview it. It's Tuesday, November 20th. It's the Tuesday before, this is the last day before Thanksgiving. And it's a tradition that we've had for many years. It's every other year. So if you were new last year, you didn't miss it because we didn't have one last year. And it's never too late to RSVP to any chamber event, so just encourage them to do that, and if they have any questions or anything, I'm here. The other thing I want you to be on the lookout, we offer from Explorers to Grade 5 after-school clubs. They're winding down. Some of them have been ending already. Some will go until the second week of November, and we're busily working on our selections and offerings for the winter session. So hopefully in the next 2 weeks, it'll be in the charger for signing up for the winter ones. We have some really cool new ones come through this winter, and I also have this, I've just found this really cool one. The people that do math science also now offer something that they do as a partnership with Crayola. It's called Artist's Passport, and it's, each week is a different culture. I just understood, isn't that really cool? So each week is a different culture where they will do an art activity very genuine and authentic to that culture. So we pick, there's China, there's something from Africa, Polynesia, Russia, I can't remember the other one. So it's very, very cool. And then also, hopefully coming out in the next 2 or 3 weeks, we started this last year and it was hugely successful, so we're gonna do it again this week here, camp during spring break. So for working parents, we will still be in session, definitely the first week. We're trying hard to make it be the second week too. So that, as well as summer camps for the 2 weeks when we get out, right after school closes, so the week of June 10th and June 17th. We're working on all those details, so that'll also be out in the next couple weeks in the charger. But any questions or thoughts of, oh, this would be a great club and you have a contact, please let me know, because we're very open to making it the best for our kids. Okay, thanks.
Okay. Karen? Okay. And now we will move along to Miriam.
Good morning, and excuse my voice. I just want to start by saying thank you to the classmates for this amazing class party. At lower school, we had a class party, where in the upper school, we didn't. I think we are older class party. So it was very nice. I saw a lot of kids coming home. Thank you for giving us more erasers, small with the Halloween thing. We have zombie and ghosts now. So the very interesting thing that I saw this year was that a lot of parents who were coming to join the class parties, and they arrived earlier before the class party, they came to us while we were all setting up the tables and asked if they could be a help and be, you know, a part of this, serving the cupcakes to the kids, which was very nice. I mean, I just need to mention and say thank you and to the others who are not here. So the next thing that we're gonna be reaching out to the class party is gonna be the holidays class parties, which we are 2 months away, you know, still we have time. We're gonna send an email to the class parents to start planning the class parties for the holidays. I think that's all I needed to mention today. Thank you.
Okay. I just wanted to just say a few words about Nina and Deb and Melissa. What goes into an event, especially the book fair and these ladies, I know Nina and Deb have been doing it quite a few years, is people don't take into consideration all the time and planning and organization that they put, not only in the week of book fair, but really the whole year. And I just wanted just to acknowledge them for what they do and what a great job you guys do, and thank you.
Love doing book fair. using the register or helping the children find what books they need, that would be great. And then for Friday, when we pack up the book fair, we'll need volunteers to help us get it ready for Scholastic to pick it up the next week. Class visits, volunteers, we will need volunteers to assist the lower school classes to come into the book fair, so you can sign up for your child's class, and then just assist the teachers in, you know, helping the kids find books and helping them. They're gonna get a wish list, and so sometimes the little kids, the pre-Kers and the kindergartners, may need assistance writing down the titles of the books, so you can assist that way. Read aloud volunteers. So the lower school has opportunities for parents to go into their child's class and read a story that they find at book fair, so that's another opportunity for you to volunteer. Clifford Upper School volunteers. So every year we get Clifford the big red dog, and the upper schoolers will sign up, and it starts dismissal on Friday, November 30th, and goes all the way through book fair, drop off, and dismissal. So they could volunteer to be in that big red costume. And
I think we should get Mr. Olvera. He's not here, is he?
It's very funny to see Big Clifford next to Barb. Yeah. It's funny in the morning to see Clifford and then right next to Barb and Gil. So. Wish list donations. So when you come to book fair, you will see a big chart with all of the teachers' names and pictures, and there will be pockets where they will have wish lists. They will go through the book fair and write down titles that they would like in their classroom, and you can purchase them and donate them to your child's teacher. Last, library donation table, that's the same kind of concept where we will
Thank you. Anya Kamenetz is a noted author. She's the NPR's, I think, education correspondent is her title, and she's written a few books, but this book is, I think, it's a very, very important topic for any parent, really society, as we are right now. So it's called The Art of Screen Time. And I think as you see in the description and when you read the book, you'll see that it's a pretty moderate stance. It's there to help. It's not turn all the screens off, live in a hut, and go away from it. But it's also not just devote your entire life to screens. So, and she's giving a guide for parents. She's a parent and an author, so she's using her life experience, her research, and pulling it all together. And it's accessible, fairly easy to read, thought-provoking book. So she's coming on January 15th. We would really like to get as many people here and also as many people who have read the book and can kind of engage with it, although you don't have to have read the book. But we would love for as many people as we can to have her, see her speak, to be able to, you know, think about what she's talking about. So tell your friends. Absolutely, it's open to the public. As we get closer, we're gonna open it up a little bit more, but you know, first priority is Chapin. It's at night, and I believe it's at 7. I think I have to confirm the exact time with Ms. Kamenetz. She's also the, her parents were my graduate school teachers. They worked together at LSU. So I don't know her, but I know her parents fairly well. I did know them fairly well. So she is awesome, and I've talked to her a little bit. The audiobook, she actually narrates the audiobook. So if that's what you like, it's on Audible and other places. So. We're really excited about it. And it really fits in with all three C's, character, curriculum, community. We do iPads here. It's a big part of, I think screen time is now a big part of community in general, and how you manage that screen time ends up being a big part of your character, not just for our kids, but for all of us.
Thank you.
She writes for the NPR website too, so if you, it's pretty easily accessible, and it's usually about education issues or around kids. She's actually quoted on our own website talking about pre-K through 8th education. So, thank you.
Just thought of ice cream bingo, like way in advance in January. But if you have